is the key. Oh man, oh man, knowledge is the key.
You are welcome to the winning platform, tagged Winning by Knowledge. The Holy Spirit is a divine facilitator, but not a replacement for the human brain. Knowledge, wisdom, and understanding are three keys that propel great success. The grace of God has brought us freedom, divine enablement, and unlimited favor. However, the grace that is abused will be lost. Any knowledge acquired but not applied has no profitable value. This platform, Winning by Knowledge, teaches a balance between personal responsibility and spiritual enablement as keys to unlimited success. You are welcome to this edition of Winning by Knowledge, anchored by Dr. Victor Falak, a pastor, a teacher, and a human resource developer.
Empowers can guide you.
Ethics or management of guest speakers. Words of wisdom. Trusting a stranger is taking a risk without guarantee. Did you hear that? Tell your neighbor, trusting a stranger. Say, trusting a stranger is taking a risk without guarantee. Trusting a stranger is taking a risk without guarantee. You see, there are some clergy that they invite strangers to their pulpit. They are taking a big risk. You go to a program, maybe in Kaduna, in Lagos, in Port Harcourt, and the guy preaches wonderful. You are emotionally carried away. And the next thing is you are extending an invitation to him. How much do you know about him apart from the 1 hour you listen to him? How much do you know about him? The person is still strange to you. You don't know his lifestyle. You don't know who he is. The person is still strange to you. So you need to be careful not to hand over your pulpit to a stranger. Welcome strangers, but trust is proven over time. Did you hear that? Welcome strangers, but trust is proven over time. Trust is proven over time. You can come to me as a stranger, I'll welcome you, I'll give you water, I'll receive you. I do that more often than not. But I won't open my bedroom to you the first day I meet you. That is an error. That is a big error. You don't do that. Welcome strangers. The stranger should have a boundary. You don't know who the person is. Hallelujah. Thank God for Father Abraham. You know, when the angels were passing by, going down to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah, says, stand by, take some drink, let me bake some cake for you, and all that. Do you know what Abraham told him? He said, wait, let me go and see my wife Sarah to prepare some cake for you. Do you know that Abraham didn't take them to the house? Shout hallelujah! Praise God! Amen. So that is just by the way, anyway. Thank God for Abraham. Hallelujah. So number one, do not release your pulpit to strangers. We're taking our scriptural ingredient from Matthew chapter 7 and verse 15. He said, beware of false prophets which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. So that's one of the reasons you need to be careful. Proverbs chapter 11, verse 15. He who is surety, to be sure, who is surety for a stranger will suffer. Did you hear that? Praise the Lord. He who is surety, sure, you give it a surety to a stranger, the Bible says he will suffer. But one who hates being surety is secure. And from the Good News Translation, it makes it simpler. It says, if you promise to pay a stranger's debt, you will regret it. Did you see that? You are paying a debt for a stranger. Now, you want to go and lock him in the police station. Ah, don't worry. I'll pay his debt. I'll pay his debt after he will repay me back. Do you know the stranger? Do you know when he's coming to repay you? The stranger that did not pay his creditor. You are paying for him to come and repay you back. You are giving guarantee to a stranger. He said, if you promise to pay a stranger's debt, you will regret it. You are better off if you don't get involved. And so please be careful. Please be careful. People are giving their pulpits to strangers, and some of them are still picking up their pieces today. Don't give your pulpit to a stranger that will come and tell your daughters in the church that wearing brazier is a sin. And when they are convinced, and when the person has left that place, I'm sure you know what it means. What your wife will go through for them to return that brazier where it left. Be careful. Tell them to be careful. Away by error. There are pastors that will meet me, you know, and all that. Please, can I preach for you? And all that, you know. And I'll just look for a way and dismiss them. I said, don't worry. In the process of time, I'll discuss with my bishop and I'll get back to you. By the time you call 1, 2, 3, 4 times, you are on your own. You have met me for the first time. You visited me. And you're so impressed in church. And the next thing is that you want me to release my pulpit to you. Me. Pastor Peter Fanak, to release pulpit to you. So we should be bigger than some things. It's you that God called. It's you that God will hold responsible. If you bring somebody that mislead the people in your congregation, it's not that person. God will hold you responsible. That flock is under your care. I leave a full animal to take care of my cow. When I come back, he will not be telling me that I left the cow under one of my friends. And I went to attend a wedding ceremony. Did I leave the cow under you or under your friend? So please, let's be careful. And God will help us in Jesus' name. Praise the Lord. The next one there is ethics of administration of invited guests. You know, at times we invite guests to our churches to come and minister. Praise the Lord. When you have an invited guest to the junior pastors that are here, please don't introduce your guest. Leave your guest to be introduced by your senior pastor or your presiding bishop or the father in the house. Don't invite, don't introduce your guest. Again, you see, it's very common. You just see maybe a junior pastor or a deacon who's coordinating the program. Oh, the great man from Kaduna is here. Oh, the man of God is here. Oh, the bishop we invited is here. Please rise to your feet and appreciate it. Oh, who are you? Abuse of protocol. That's an abuse of protocol. You don't do that. I can't be invited or I can't be welcoming an invited guest when my bishop is seated for what? How? It's an error. Please, you don't do that. You can only do that with the permission of your father in the house. If he permits you to do that, you do that. If he doesn't, don't do that. In Matthew chapter 3, and verse 17. And know the voice from heaven say, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. So who introduced Jesus to us? Who introduced him? John was just preparing the way. One will come, I'm not ready to carry his sandal, I'm not ready to untie his shoe and all that. But when the time for introduction came, God gave the introduction. God give us understanding in Jesus' name. Number two, have respect for denominational doctrines. And I have a word of wisdom there. To respect place of honors is not compromised by civilization. Did you hear that? Can I hear you say to respect the doctrine of honors? Say it as you mean it. To respect the doctrine of honors is not compromised by civilization. Praise the Lord. If you are invited as a guest, where you are going to minister, if they remove shoe before they enter the church, remove your shoe. And remove your shoe before you enter. If you cannot remove your shoe, don't honor the invitation. Don't honor the invitation. I know time without number that you know some sisters will ask questions. Okay, if I go to this place now, should I put on my heta or I don't put on my heta? I should tell them this about heta. All that I'll finish telling you about heta, I will always end up by telling you that when you go to where they put on heta, put on my heta. If you don't do it, that is rebellion. You are rebelling against a constituted authority. So if they put on heta in that place, put on heta. If they remove their shoe before entering church, remove your shoe. If you are not ready to respect that doctrine, you should leave. I'm going to where you came from. At times my wife will be going to somewhere and I'll need to remind her quickly. You know where you are going to, you need to put on veil on your head. You need to put on head tie on your head. And she will always say, I know. Tell your neighbor, I know. Praise the Lord. Amen. So please, that is very important. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 4 to 7. For when one says, I am of Paul, and another says, I am of Apollos, and another says, I am of... and he says, are you not carnal? Why? Who then is Paul? And who is Apollos? The ministers through whom you believe, as the Lord gave to each one. And it goes on to say, one planted, one water, and at the end of the day, it's God that gives life, you know, and all that. So wherever it is, the one that is saying, put on a tie, he is planted. Another one says, don't put on a tie, that is Apollos. The other one that is saying this, that is Silas. The other one is Paul. Whatever it is, at the end of the day, we are all building towards one goal. So that we should stop fighting ourselves over these trivial issues and all that. If you call me to come and ask me to remove my shoe, I'll remove my shoe. I'll remove it. But at the end of the day, I'll preach the message that God sent me to preach and I'll leave and go. Is it a shoe that is preaching the message? So why are you moving to refuse it to me? At times, we quarrel over issues that are just nonentities. That are just uncalled for. Remove the shoe and preach the message and go. Praise God. Number three, accept what you are offered for refreshment. Luke chapter 10, verse 8. And into whatsoever city you enter, and they receive you, eat such things as are set before you. Praise the Lord. I have seen guest ministers that make choices that their host cannot afford. That their host cannot afford. He buys you a bottle of soft drink, say Coca-Cola, for 100 naira. And you are giving him a brand of wine that is 5,000 naira. And even the honorarium he has kept from you is not up to 5,000. You are already telling him that you need a wine for 5,000 naira. So don't put your horse under pressure. Don't put your horse under pressure. So when you are invited somewhere to go and minister, don't put your horse under unnecessary pressure. The things that are placed before you, of course you know that if your host had the best, your host would have given you the best. And so what you find before you, appreciate God for it. So that you don't put your host under unnecessary pressure. Praise the Lord. Number four, We've spoken about that a little bit earlier. We said, do not perform an additional assignment not given to you. So when you are a host, when you are an invited guest, please make sure that you key to the assignment. If I have a team for a program, and I invited you for the team of that program, don't come and create another team for me. Don't come and create another topic for me. So don't go as a host and begin to create another topic. So when you were invited, your host sent the topic to you. Is that true? The topic is sent to you or what you are coming to minister on. And so don't come and recreate the team. The person has a purpose for that topic and for inviting you to preach on that topic. The environment where I operate, I understand the needs within that environment. And so I call you to come up so that we can fill up the deficit, the gap, the need within that environment. So don't come back and come and recreate. To come and recreate the team for me. I emphasize some of those things in my book I titled The Voice of the People is Not the Voice of God. If you read that book, I indicated something there, you know, by saying that don't allow people to redefine the vision God gave to you. You need people, people are good, people need to support you, you know, you need a teamwork, but there's a chapter where I need to define the limitation of the people. And part of the limitation is that they must not redefine your vision. Praise the Lord. And so when you are invited, please let's be careful to make sure that we don't go to redefine the team of the program. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Just thank you for the word we have today. Just say, Father, I give you praise. Father, I thank you for your word. Father, I thank you for your word. Father, I give you praise. Father, thank you for the increase for today. I want you to begin to confess to yourself and say, I'm getting better, I'm getting wiser, I'm getting stronger. Father, we thank you. Talk to God, I can hear you appreciating God. Say, Father, I give you good prayers tonight. Thank you for the word. Thank you for the understanding. Thank you for speaking to us again this morning. Thank you for the understanding. Thank you for the increase in knowledge. Thank you for the increase in wisdom. Thank you for the increase in understanding. Thank you for taking us to another height. Thank you for bringing us to a new level. Father, we give you praise. 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 The Lord God Almighty will bless you. And as we keep to these edges, we pray that these edges will help you, will help your ministry, will upflesh your ministry, will bring things in your ministry, and your ministry will grow better in the name of Jesus.
God has said, my people, yes, my people, are destroyed for lack of knowledge. So win by knowledge. Knowledge is the key. So win by wisdom. Wisdom is the key. So win by understanding. Is there